What's going on, everybody? Welcome back to the BTR Garage. My name is Justin. Today we're going to be bringing you some baseline oil pressure testing from Chuckwallet Valley Raceway in my GR86. We got some laps, we got some data analysis. Let's go ahead and get started. So the purpose of this lapping day at Chuckwallet was to essentially gather baseline oil pressure data for my GR86 before I install my Cosma oil pan baffle, which I have right here. Obviously, so when I do install the baffle and I get the oil pressure data from that, I can compare and contrast what the difference was when the car didn't have the baffle. So there's three topics we're going to talk about in today's video. The first one being proving out that I did indeed have the right turn low oil pressure situations with my GR86, which of course I do. The second topic or test that I was able to perform was actually comparing oil temperatures and how those affect oil pressures. That was pretty interesting. We'll show you that as well. And then lastly, the third topic or third test was actually testing a half a quart oil overfill in the car. So essentially adding a half a quart of oil beyond the max fill line on the dipstick. And then of course, seeing how that affected our right turn oil pressure situations. Now from a car setup perspective, I'll give you a quick rundown. My 2022 GR86 has a little over 12,000 miles. We're running on GT Radial SX2 tires on the OEM rims. The car has Eibach lowering springs, Petters top hats, and SPC camber bolts in the front, SPL rear lower control arms in the back for 3 degrees of negative front camber and 2.5 degrees of negative rear camber. Otherwise, the suspension is stock OEM shocks and OEM power as well, so no power additions on the car. We do have a Jackson Racing oil cooler to help keep the oil temperatures down. And of course, we have the oil pressure sensor in there going through the GJP IO box that allows us to capture all of that data through the CAN bus. But let's go ahead and throw it on track and get started. So we'll roll through a full lap here at Chuckwallet. Again, just trying to get proof that we are actually getting low oil pressures during the right-hand turns. You'll notice in our race chrono data overlay, we got all the necessary details. We have oil pressure highlighted in green down there. You can see we slipped into the 40s already on oil pressure. We have our oil temperature in the upper right and the rest of the good stuff down below and up top from a timing perspective. Swinging through the left-hander here, not a big deal. The track was super dusty this weekend. It was the first after the summer break, so a very slow track. But we're going to go ahead and pause the video here for just a second. The next two right-handed turns, turns 6 and 7, are the problem turns on Chuckwallet for the GR86. Turn 3 was the turn we went through a moment ago, which is less of an issue, and then turn 16, also a tight right-hander, but not a big deal from an oil pressure perspective. So I use this turn 6 and 7 area that we're driving through right now as the focal point for all of my testing for the day because it was super easy to reproduce the low oil pressure situation in those set of turns. And if you were paying close attention through that turn 6 and 7 section, you would have noticed that our oil temperature is pretty low, only 208 degrees, 210 degrees, and that's because the ambient temperatures weren't very hot and it was very humid. And also back in turn 6 and 7, the RPM ranges were in the 4500 to 5500 range, and that's because that particular turn is too fast for second gear, and third gear just kind of keeps you in the middle of the RPM range. So that could also result in higher oil pressures, so keep that in mind as we go through the rest of the data. Heading into the bowl at Chuckwallet, this is a 10 degree right hand banked turn that's very long and decently fast. I thought this would be a problem area, but it turned out to be a non-issue, probably because the bank kept the oil in the bottom of the oil pan versus the lateral G's pushing it to the side of the oil pan. But anyways, cruising through the last couple left-handed turns here, we'll come up onto the final turn of the track, or the final couple turns, and a little bit of a drift session going through there. The car was very squirrely on turn-in, which resulted in several of those slides and fun sequences like that. But here's that right-handed turn again. Not really an issue with a mild pressure drop towards the end of the turn here, and that wraps up the lap. So now we're going to jump inside the Race Chrono app and look at the data analysis. Here with the blue line, we can very clearly see the oil pressure drops in that turn 6 through 7 section. And remember, this is the laps where we had maximum oil fill on the car, meaning I had the oil only filled up to the max fill line on the dipstick. There was no overfilling of the oil. So we have another lap example here. This was obviously a different lap, but a whole bunch of the same. We lose oil pressure on the turn-in, and then towards the exit or mid-corner and exit, we have a lot of oil pressure loss as well. And then one more example we'll throw up. We have some big dips again. I think the peaks and the valleys there are due to the car sliding and slipping around, so sloshing in the oil pan, I believe, contributes to the large drops in oil pressure as well. All right, so we've established that we also have low oil pressure in the right-hand turns, to the surprise of probably nobody that's been following this topic. And again, remember, under higher RPM and higher oil temperature situations, I would fully expect these pressures to be even lower than what I saw in my lower RPM range and lower oil temperature situations. So with that, we're gonna move on to the oil temperature testing part and show you how that makes a difference on the oil pressure. So what we're looking at here is two different laps from the same exact session. Lap number one, the oil pressure is represented by the brighter blue line, and yes, I did spell brighter wrong there, and also the brighter purple line being the oil temperature. Lap number four, later on in the same session, oil pressure represented by the darker blue or gray line and the darker purple line. A quick interruption to remind you all, if you have not done already, please hit the subscribe button, share the video with your friends if this was a helpful video. I'd love to see you guys in the future. Let's jump back to the video. Switching over to the live replay of the laps, it's pretty clear right away that even a 15 degree difference in oil temperature has a pretty significant effect on the oil pressure. The delta between the top line, or the brighter blue line, which is our first lap out with lower oil temperatures, is quite a bit higher than the darker blue or the gray line, where we're in four laps later and we have about a 219-220 degree Fahrenheit oil temperature. Now, one thing to note is that this lap was done during my third session, where I did have an extra half quart of oil added to the car. So we're going through that T6 and T7 section where we had significant drops earlier, and you can see here we have a little bit of a drop with the warmer oil, but with the cooler oil the drops are not nearly as bad as they were when we were at the max fill line of oil. We'll go into greater detail on the difference between a max level fill and a half a quart overfill in the next section, so let's wrap this one up. So as we saw, oil temperature does have a pretty big difference on the oil pressure. The takeaway here is that oil coolers definitely help. So next up, the test is half a quart of extra oil over the max fill line on the dipstick. We're gonna see how that affects the oil pressure as well. Jumping right into the data analysis here. So we have lap number two, the 213.94. This is our lap where we had a half a quart of extra oil in the engine. The reference lap, or R1211.81, is the lap in a different session where we had the oil filled to the max level line on the dipstick. My goal was to get two laps with similar oil temperatures so that the oil pressure was not skewed as much by the temperature. And you can see when we're going in a straight line or even the left-hand turn here, the oil pressures are pretty close to the same. So we're making our way up to that T6 and T7 section. Again, you're seeing big drops on the darker line. That's the max fill line. And then again, right here towards the middle and exit of the corner, the same kind of thing. However, the extra oil, the half quart oil, is much more consistent and we don't have as big of a drop that we did with the max fill line oil. And as you can see here, with the oil temperatures within a few degrees of each other, they are pretty stable when not in those right-hand turn situations. Stable in that they are staying very close together. Here we have two different laps, again comparing the half quart overfill versus the max fill on the dipstick. You'll notice that the oil temperatures aren't quite as close together as they were on the previous laps, but the trends overall stay the same. Larger drops in oil pressure when the oil is filled to the max fill line on the dipstick. And once again, we have not quite as bad of drops, if at all, when we're half a quart overfilled. And also, as a reference, this 211.69 lap was my fastest lap of the weekend. We're again approaching that turn 6 and 7 section where we're gonna see a really big difference in the half a quart overfill versus the max fill line on the dipstick. Mid corner and corner exit, it is pretty dramatic actually how much the difference is. And I'll stress once again, if we were to add 1000 RPM and say 20 degrees more of oil temperature through that same section, all of those oil pressures are gonna come down. So the lows in the 30s are gonna become lows in the 20s. With the max fill and then the half quart overfill, we might see lows in the 40s versus lows in the 50s and that kind of thing. We'll pull up some still shots of the T6 and T7 areas and highlight those danger zones. And you can see here, We have quite a significant drop in oil pressure with the max fill compared to the half quart overfill. And outside of that big drop there, the half quart overfill is pretty consistent compared to the max fill. Here is the still shot of the other example we showed a minute ago, and highlighting the danger area, you can see we're actually bouncing off the 30 psi for the low point on the max fill line, and the half quart overfill is quite a bit more consistent here with only one small drop into the 50 psi range. So after looking through that data, it's pretty clear that the half a quart of extra oil does help maintain those oil pressures under right-hand turn situations. Clearly, it doesn't totally eliminate it based on the data that we have here, but it does help, and I would recommend doing that as well if you're tracking your car a lot. And again, I'll mention it one more time, but this particular turn we were testing on was lower RPM than what you might see in other faster right-handers. So expect higher RPM situations, higher oil temp situations to have lower oil pressures as a result. But at any rate, the extra oil in the pan is definitely helpful. So we're gonna wrap up this video. Thanks again, everybody, for watching. I appreciate you hanging out with me today. If you haven't already, please consider subscribing to the channel down below. Share the video with your friends. I'd love to see you in the future. Don't forget, we got more videos coming up very soon. We're heading to Chuckwalla Raceway again in less than 2 weeks here to test out my Cosma oil pan baffle. We'll be getting that installed here next weekend, so keep an eye out for that video as well. And like always, if you have any thoughts, comments, or questions, please leave them down below. I would love to hear from you. Stay safe out there. I am checking out. We'll talk to you all next time.